Michael and Julianne have been best friends for years.
The one constant thing in my life is that he'll always be there.
But what will Julianne do when the one guy she could always count on...
Call me, 4 in the morning, whatever, we gotta talk.
Pops the question...
I called because I met someone.
...to someone else.
Well...
We're getting married.
Pleasure of Your Company is requested at My Best Friend's Wedding, starring Julia Roberts, Dermot Mulroney, Cameron Diaz, and Rupert Everett.
Diaz?
Well, the character that I play, she's a food critic. She's very devoted to her career. She has this best friend that she's had forever, and she discovers that he's getting married, and so that's how the story takes off.
He was in love with me every day for 9 years. Me!
I can see why.
Look, she has known him for, what, like 5 seconds? I can't lose him, George. I'm a busy girl. I've got exactly 4 days to break up a wedding, steal the bride's fella, and I haven't one clue how to do it.
I think it's a pretty simple story.
Huh.
Maybe it's not that simple. It's about this... friendship and a new love relationship and how those two relationships conflict.
Oh, you know, I've never had a sister. All I've heard is Julianne this and Julianne that.
Michael and I were a wrong fit right from the start.
He said that too. Kim, you can't help but to feel that she's being left out a little bit.
The only fear she really has is you.
So this means that I have 4 days to make you my new best friend and be my maid of honor. What?
Why not? You're practically the best man anyway.
I just asked myself, what would Lucy Ricardo do in this situation? She goes into scheme mode, but I don't think it's her forte, and she sort of schemes the way Lucy Ricardo schemes, where all of her plans are thwarted left and right, and she just makes a mess of everything.
Who's that guy?
It's George. George.
Hey, congratulations.
What?
I told him, George, if we're engaged, why be ashamed of it, right?
Something wrong.
It's just a big surprise.
We thought you were a lesbian.
George is sort of her best friend, second in command. He's her editor, someone that she works with, someone that, you know, lives in New York where she lives.
I come to comfort her, thinking maybe I'll take her back to New York or something like that. Instead, she tells him that she's married, getting married to me, at which point I have to act like I'm her fiancé. But I'm sort of infuriated by this, and I decide to humiliate her.
Underplay.
Got it. Hey! I'm Jules' fiancé, George. Just in time for a quick pre-conjugal visit, if you catch my drift.
We have to talk about George.
You were jealous?
Crazy jealous.
Personally, I think Mr. Michael's marrying the wrong girl.
There's some trouble because she wants one thing and Michael may want another and Kimberly definitely wants one thing. Julianne is trying to take that wrench and just ram it in the gears and hilarity ensues.
God, I've got it all figured out.
My Best Friend's Wedding was brought to the screen by P.J. Hogan, the director of Muriel's Wedding, and was produced by Jerry Zucker and Ron Bass.
Here we go, guys.
Chicago played host to My Best Friend's Wedding, and crowds gathered to watch as the cast and crew filmed at some of the city's leading landmarks.
There's chases and scenes all over Chicago. I'd always hoped to work in Chicago because I went to school at Northwestern and I knew the city a little bit, but this is the way to go.
I love shooting in Chicago. These incredible buildings. It's a Chicago skyline. It's like a showroom for the world's great architects, and they take the opportunity to show off.
All right, yes. Let's try a rehearsal.
And then I go like this, and I go, here we go. It's really hard to find an interesting, good, original comedy. So this one was very appealing to me.
You're gonna humiliate me, aren't you?
If I can.
Rupert Everett is just one of the funniest people on the planet, you know. It's very difficult, ultimately, to act with Rupert because I'm not really supposed to be laughing at all the things that he's telling me, and it's incredibly hard not to.
A lot of people don't know who Rupert is, so there's an element of surprise about his performance.
Action!
It all started with Ron Bass, one of the great and prolific writers in Hollywood.
And I read the script right away. Actually, my wife read it first and said, Jerry, you have to read this script right now.
I attended the wedding of one of my best friends, a brilliant film editor named David Brenner, in Chicago. And I said, what a great thing. We're all just here to celebrate. And then this one Lucy Ricardo figure gets dropped down in the middle of all that simplicity, happiness, sweetness, and light. It seemed like a perfect conflict for comedy.
My God, it's the bride and the woman she'll never live up to.
Mandy and Sammy are on to Julianne. When Julianne arrives, it's like they see straight into her soul. They see a woman in love, and they know who she's in love with.
She believes it will be the best for everyone, ultimately, if her little scheme works, which, of course, is completely narcissistic and wrong and all those things, but at least she's high-spirited about it.
While the White Sox took on the Oakland A's on the field, Julianne scored big points with the home team.
Now remember, it is the duty of the best man to dance with the maid of honor.
You can't dance. When did you learn how to dance?
I've got moves you've never seen.
You're an imposter. What did you do with my best friend?
Huh? I'm still your best friend. Just haven't seen you for a while.
Julia is witty, intelligent, and beautiful.
Let's just start again, don't cut.
When I met her, I realized that is her. It's not something she fakes. I thought if I could get who Julia Roberts is, unadulterated Julia Roberts, on film, in this role, it will be a knockout.
And I'll add one more thing to that. She's funny between takes. We're listening in our earphones, you know, and we can still hear the patter while we're waiting to reset the scene. And she's making jokes and making the crew and everybody laugh between takes.
I think we should all take a little group therapy moment. Join hands.
I like doing comedy, you know, enjoy it. And when things go well, it's not like, oh, well, we're all so jaded and they've gone well before. It's that you're legitimately excited that you've done something that's effective, whether it be funny or sad or whatever you're going for.
I'm gonna take Everett from here.
It's not a problem.
We have the scene where Julia's character, Julianne, is supposed to fall while she's wearing this dress that's too tight for her.
Here we go. Space. Parker?
Our first take, Julia started to take a step off of the pedestal she's standing on. Nobody knew that this was going to happen. We were laughing so hard. We were just completely, I just almost died.
I was so glad I didn't get hurt, that it actually was an accident, a total accident. It was hilarious, and it had us laughing on set forever.
After closing time, Chicago's most famous department store became a movie studio for a scene where Julianne buys a little time.
It was wonderful to shoot after hours because I felt like I had the whole place to myself. I could do whatever I wanted. I felt naughty.
Does this have the soundproof bottom?
Kimmy is pretty self-assured. I mean, she's a girl who's knows what she wants, and she's going after it, definitely. At Marshall Field's, this is where Julianne has decided that she's going to mix the pot a little bit, stir things up.
She sort of plows through certain pieces of information that she's gathered since her arrival and finds an Achilles heel for this relationship.
Michael, please do this for Daddy. Please, 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 blah, blah, blah. It's only for 6 months, and it would mean so much to me.
That was actually a really hard scene to do because at the end of every take, I just was like, I'm terrible, you know?
Yeah. Look at me, no ulterior motive.
Camera reload.
Okay, I'll just check.
Tell you what, we're gonna go straight in on this. Picture will be up.
Well, I think one of the real signature scenes in the movie is this crazy scene that takes place in this Crab House restaurant. Very Hogan-esque scene, I think. If anyone's seen Muriel's Wedding, this one has a lot of that kind of very believable but completely bizarre. And Rupert just turned in a tour de force performance in that scene.
George is a fairly quiet, introverted man who gets put into a situation and suddenly becomes a kind of demon.
Parker?
How did you and Julianne meet?
It's a very romantic story. Would you like to tell it, sweetie?
No, it's private.
Oh, not anymore. I first met Julianne in a mental institution. Julianne was there visiting some French chef she'd sent insane with a bad review. And I was there visiting Dionne Warwick.
Dionne Warwick?
Well, yes, he thought he was Dionne Warwick.
You see, there again, I have to sit next to Rupert as he's doing this hilarious routine at the Crab House and not laugh.
I bet Julia $100 on the first take that she couldn't get through it without laughing.
But I won.
What comb in my hair now? While wondering what dress to wear now.
I say a little prayer for you.
Forever and ever, you stay in my heart, and I will love you forever and ever. You never will part. Oh, how I love you together forever. That's how it must be to live without you. Would only mean heartbreak for me.
I love music. I really wanted that in the film. I really wanted the joy and love that the music brings.
For My Best Friend's Wedding, executive producers Gil Netter and Patricia Witcher put together an impressive team behind the camera. Laszlo Kovacs was the director of photography. Two-time Academy Award winner Richard Silbert served as production designer, and Oscar nominee Jeffrey Curlin designed the costumes.
I would say that every single day of a film is like staging a wedding. And you get to the end of the day, the wedding was a big success or it wasn't. You can't really enjoy the successful day because you've got another wedding tomorrow.
The perfect mansion for Kimmy's family was found at the Cuneo Museum and Gardens, a spectacular 75-acre estate built in 1914.
This picture needed not only a large estate, of which there are many, but one with a very, very strong personality.
At that point in the film, you'd have to know the impact that the Wallace Mansion has to have on Julianne. She walks in through the doorway, and it's a jaw dropper. I wanted to find a jaw dropper, and was one of those times where I go to a location, and there are things that are written into the script, waiting for us.
Neil, Julia turning back like that seems better, doesn't it?
Hey, it's working.
I make it work for the scene, man.
Well, that's what I'm saying. You're really showing up today.
I'm not phoning it in today.
No, not
like
today.
Like I did yesterday, and the day before that, and the day before that.
I went to go see Muriel's wedding with my sister. It was so beautifully executed and so well done. And I think that PJ has an amazing capacity for detail. I think that his sense of humor is vast and precise, and that he really sort of has a clear idea of how he wants things to go.
It could be as superbly funny.
I sort of like the fact that he's, you know, especially in America, considered rather new, and so he still has that sort of energy that I have for, you know, making movies.
Okay, that's a cut.
It's find life so funny that if you observe and take note, it's in the details.
My sister was licking an ice sculpture and her tongue froze right to it. It's a sculpture of the David.
There we go.
Dare to push something to the point of silly and beyond. Know when to pull back, but sometimes you end up with really great things.
My relationship with PJ started off on a very untrustworthy footing. I had lunch with PJ and Julia. They were both talking about Muriel's wedding. I just lied right to his face. Yeah, I loved the movie. I hadn't seen it.
Now it's gonna be like Pavlovian. I hit my head 67 Park West, please.
I just want Mark on this rehearsal. We can give it.
And we can give
it. Hey, this rehearsal, I want it.
Yes. Where'd you find this place?
The doorman told me about it. And I think I hear Tom Jones calling you.
In the scene in the karaoke bar, Julianne has just gotten to town, and we go out and have a good time. You begin to see how the dynamics are unfolding.
Give it up, folks, please, for the vocal stylings of Miss Kimberly Wallace!
Cameron's character, Kimmy, tries to sing, but man, she can't sing.
Going to a movie!
And what I think's really funny in that scene is that you have two totally different perspectives of what's happening. And it's just horrendous. Now, this doesn't affect my character at all because I see right through it to, you know, to the woman I love.
So great. I got both my best girls in the same room. Where did the mic go?
Folks thirsty?
Margarita.
Blended no
she
salt.
Wants it straight up.
There's two romances going on. You know, there's this friendship. You fall in love with that relationship as well. Those two romances share a common link, and that's Michael.
Michael and Julianne, I think, have a sort of unique relationship where it has sort of crossed all the lines that friendship shouldn't cross.
I've seen you a lot more naked than that.
They're always very attracted to one another, but know the pitfalls of that, so just remain the best of friends. And I think the reason why the boat is particularly special is because it's the first time that you see Michael and Julianne entirely alone, just to talk.
We got to shoot one of the scenes on this skyline tour boat in the Chicago River, looking up at all these buildings just slowly moving by you. I just thought it was a beautiful place to set a scene, you know, it was a nice cruise for the day.
Okay, and roll sound, rolling.
Is your dance card filled?
Oh, I'd have to check. I have it on power book these days. I really enjoy acting with Dermot Mulroney, and in a scene like that, he makes my job incredibly easy in the way that he performs his half of the scene. You know, PJ was like saying, oh, that was a great scene, thank you. I said, thank Dermot, you know, I didn't have to do anything, you know.
That was great.
That's sort of a luxury that I've had with all the actors that I've worked with on this movie.
It just feels like one of those movies where everybody's in the right spot, in the right time in their life, and in the right character. I think that's when you get a good movie, is when people are where they belong at that time in their life.
Oh, and you like her.
I didn't have to hate her, I'd adore her.
Did you really love him? Or was this just about winning?
Kimmy's conflict is she's feeling a little like she doesn't know quite where these two are at right now.
The movie does vacillate back and forth about what's gonna happen. The interesting thing about this movie is that as you get to know these people better and become more in touch with, you know, who they really are and how they really feel about one another, you keep changing your mind a little bit about what you think should happen, what you want to happen. Then I'm constantly saying to, you know, Dermot, like hitting him on set, you know, there's still time, you still think about it, you know.
I realize this comes at a very inopportune time. Marry me.
Oh.
Finding love and being loved is one of the most difficult things. And I think romantic comedies shed light on that search.
Yeah!
Michael!
Lovely together.
Michael!
That's our maid of honor. She's from New York.
Ah.